Well, good morning, everyone, and a good Palm Sunday morning to you all. Well, we are, the rest of the world is preparing for Easter egg hunts. We're preparing for Holy Week, and I hope that means something to you. Just a few notes. There's a separate insert in your bulletin just highlighting some of the elements of this week. Thursday nights, Monday, Thursday, and we'll do as we've done before. We'll gather in the fellowship hall around tables. We'll share what is not a real big meal, but just kind of a light meal to remind us of early church agape supper, and we'll have communion there, fellowship around the tables. We've had a couple different times floating around for that, but it's 6:30. So if you see it listed 7 o'clock somewhere, ignore it and come at 6:30. Plan to be there. Obviously, Easter is next Sunday, and we will have our normal worship services at 9 and 11. They tend to be a little fuller than normal, so if you desperately need your seat, get here a little early. And as we've done for many years, because of the generous ability of a number of our people in the congregation to volunteer their time, we'll have a brunch here in the fellowship hall between services. There's no cost. You don't need to buy tickets. Just come and enjoy and spend some extra time together with the body of Christ. And if you've signed up to bring stuff, make sure that you get it on time. They start assembling things Friday, so don't plan to bring it Sunday morning unless you're bringing something prepared. And I know most of you come at 9, but we have some switch hitters that'll come at 11. If you're going to attend the 11 o'clock service, come to brunch at 10:30, because there's always the big crunch right after we let the service out. By then it's died out. We've never run out of food yet, so I wouldn't worry about that too much. Other announcements this morning. Yes, Greg. Okay. Any other announcements? Well, then why don't we all stand up and say good morning to each other as we become worship.
Are you ready?
Children.
Jesus who had blessed them goes home into his breast. The children sang their praises, the simplest and the best. From Olivet they followed a happy, joyous crowd. Their large palm branches waving and singing clear and loud. The Lord of men and angels rode on in simple joy. Then welcomed all the children, each little girl and boy.
Repeat after me, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Once again, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Go, Hosanna, Lord, save us.
from Philippians, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow.
You were the Word at the beginning. Sing. One with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil before you. Silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are glory, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again.
Sing on.
You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all.
What a powerful name, what a powerful name it is.
What a powerful name it is. The name
Please be seated. And please join me in prayer.
Father, we hate to admit it, but we are often so much like those pilgrims on Palm Sunday. When we met you on Sunday, we were excited, we cheered, we waved, we gave you our whole heart. And then later in the week, we kind of forgot. Maybe something you wanted us to do didn't line up with what we wanted, or maybe we just had other priorities, or maybe we just got so busy we forgot about Sunday. And yes, Lord, we repeat that over and over and over again, just like they did. So, Father, even as we come in joy and celebration and adoration this Sunday, we confess that there are times in our life when that all just evaporates and we just fall back on ourselves. And that shows how we're broken. So hear us, Lord, in a few moments of silence as we offer up our own personal confession of our brokenness to you. Father, as we come up on this week, we remember the ultimate act of betrayal when those who you came to love and teach and care for decided they would turn their backs on you and kill you. And your response to that was the resurrection, was to die for our sins, was to not even let death hold you down. And so, Father, we are assured that as we come to you in confession every Sunday morning or every time in our life when we need to, that your overwhelming love for us is greater than anything that we could do. Friends, hear and believe the good news, the wondrous news, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen.
Amen.
Deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretched treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away. As wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no way. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. What should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Well, kids, you don't have very far to go this morning to come up. Great job this morning. Thank you very much. That was fun. Thank you. Have your problems. Just, you know, don't put anybody's eye out with them. You know, for us, these are really unusual. I grew up in Southern California. We had palm trees everywhere. And I didn't ever think about what an odd-looking tree they were. But I would see people coming from like Minnesota and they'd come to California. I'd see them staring at a palm tree. Like, what's wrong with you? You know, it's just a tree. We don't have a lot of palm trees up here, do we? Even in Yakima, the Palm Springs of Washington. But back in Jesus's day, the nation of Israel, palms were very important to them. They were everywhere. On days like Palm Sunday, they would wave them when they were celebrating. We think of Jews maybe as like having a Star of David for their symbol, but back then they used a palm branch. And you should find palm branches on coins. And when they had certain celebrations, like the celebration of booths or tabernacles, they built shelters out of palm branches and stayed in them. So they were pretty obsessed with these parts of these trees. But you know who else is obsessed with parts of trees? Dogs. Like, where's the dog? Where's the dog? Even if they're too big to carry, it doesn't matter. I am bamboozled by this door thing, but I don't want to give up my stick. There we go. Watch. I want this stick bad. Now this is just like mean. Wait, what do I do now? I'm tracked by my stick. Please let me in. Let me and my stick in. I'm going to get it. I will mess with you with a stick, even though I'm just a chimp. Yeah, this is not the smartest dog ever.
was too. I'm grown. Okay, kicked out of the party.
This is my favorite one, though. Okay. A little bit of fun there. You know what's cool about Palm Sunday is it was a day that everybody was excited. Well, not everybody, but almost everybody got really excited about Jesus and what they thought he was going to do in their life. And I have just a simple message. You know what? You shouldn't always feel like you have to be excited about God and who God is and what he's done. But you should every now and then. That you should feel like, God, you're so cool. You love me so much. You've done so much for me. I'm excited about you. Maybe I won't walk through town waving branches. But in my heart, I'm excited about you. So Palm Sunday is that one Sunday of the year where we really say to ourselves, you know what? It's okay to be excited about God. In fact, God probably really thinks it's cool when we are. So think of the palm branches and think about Jesus and think about how exciting it is to have a God that loves you that much. God, thank you for this day, reminding us how cool it is that you came to earth to be with us, to love us, to teach us, to die for us, to rise again for us, to do these amazing things. And when that settles in our hearts, sometimes, yeah, we're just a little excited. We do pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, everybody. You can keep those or you can deposit them in the back on your way out. But keep them. Well, we had to keep them because we need them probably for Sunday school, right? Well. Friends, what would you like to share this morning before we spend some time in prayer? Good. Wonderful. Good to hear. Say hi to him for us all. Who else? I see a hand way in the back.
Okay, here's a new updated on bill. It's great to talk to everybody all at once. So we've seen him, Bill, a couple times last week. He's in a hospital bed now, in a bedroom. His appetite is still excellent, but Sally's having a baby. I'm not sure exactly where his eyesight is. You know, he can hold a cup of water and he can bring it to his mouth, but as far as making eye contact with, I'm not sure that he really does make eye contact with. So his attitude is still good, his long-term memory is still good. Short-term memory, you know, is still wobbly. It's kind of funny when we can't think of things we don't feel, and he, so that's weird. But you know, his attitude is good, but he is regressive. He can't get out of bed by himself. Jim and my brother-in-law or son-in-law were able to take him to the bathroom in the bulk of it. But as far as him having mobility,
and he's still a big man.
That's the latest on
him. Okay, thank you. Gretchen?
Rick, thank you for your prayers. Rick's pathology report was everything was benign.
Great. Oh, yes, that's Jan.
This last week, my brother, Brian, who has Alzheimer's, was moved from Bellingham down to Anacortes because of care issues up in Bellingham. So just some prayers for his transition. You know, he doesn't verbally communicate much, but just in terms of a new environment and new people and all of that is very upsetting to people with Alzheimer's. So, anyway, keep writing in the prayers.
Okay. Robin.
Thanks, everyone, who prayed for my dad.
has pneumonia. He was with us for 10 days. So Chris had his father-in-law at our house for 10 days. Thank you everyone for bringing your meals. Like just even here in the afternoon, it's just such a beautiful moment of what my grace can do in the showing of our next steps. So thank you. And then the other phrase I have, you can only imagine discovery is going to be a long, too much of everything. So thanks to one of those. And I just went to Rand Nation and it works for you. Also, praise for Marissa. I don't know if y'all met Marissa for the first time. I'm going to be right here. She's going to be most of the time. Marissa's our nursery attendant, and it's just a lot of things I can say for her. She decorated the doors up there, she did the clothing boards, and she started a little birthday card ministry for our open gym kids. And the moms who started sending these pictures and a little card they were receiving, and they talked about just people that are involved and seeing this again every Friday in our open gym. So praise for the love and care that she showed all of us.
Amen. Other prayers?
I think we should pray about Open Gym. I think it is an amazing ministry. And I talked to Carol Brothers, who substituted, and she just was really in awe of all these moms and families that are coming. And it is in our church. It is such a ministry. And Robin, I'm so grateful to God for what you started. But let's pray for those families that they would, you know, they become, they're not Christians. I don't even know where their faith is, but they're in our church every Friday, right?
Okay. Yeah, and feel free to stop by any Friday at 10:30 a.m.
And she said it was a blast just to sit and read these
families. It is fun to watch.
Yeah.
What else? I don't know if any of you follow the Seattle news, but this last week there was a horrific car crash in which 4 people were killed, 3 children, 1 adult, 2 others seriously injured, all about 12 or 13. And these are good Christian folks. They were homeschooling. They're part of a good Christian family. Their faith is sustaining them, but they are our brothers and sisters in Christ, even if we don't know them. So we should be, hope we'll lift them up in prayer. I can't imagine losing my wife and my 2 daughters all at once. And that's what one man is facing. So pray for them and pray for what's going on in the rest of the world. We may be at odds with Russia, but they had a horrible terrorist attack 2 days ago and targeting all the wrong people, all just innocent civilians. And Ukraine is getting bombed heavily again. Things are terrible in Gaza. And let's just keep praying for this broken world that God may grant us favor that we probably don't deserve. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the assurance that you do love us, even though we continue to act often so stupidly. And we look at the brokenness in our world, and we just don't even know what to do sometimes, don't even know how to pray. So this and all the other prayers we offer this morning, we lay in your hands, knowing that as our loving Father, you will give us the very best that you have to give.
Father, we do thank you that Robin's dad is doing better. Pray that he will continue to heal and that the whole process will be a redemptive time for the whole family. Father, for Open Gym, we're just thrilled to hear the sounds of children playing in your house. And we pray for them and for their families that they would come to find a comfort here and that you might, in your own way, work on their hearts to make them wonder what this place is all about and maybe who you are all about. That will be the start of your tugging at their hearts. Father, for this family in Redden who's just lost people, just an unimaginable amount of grief they must be facing. We pray for the father who lost a wife and two children. We pray for the two children that are still in intensive care. We pray that they will be healed and restored to full health. And the families even ask that we pray for the young man who drove irresponsibly fast and crashed into them, that you might work in his life. And so we lay this all in your hands and ask that your loving care would surround them. As we think about other places in our world far away that we know only from the distant news, a terrorist attack in Russia, a new bombing campaign in Ukraine, a continued conflict in Gaza, and we wish that somehow there was something we could do to make this all go away. But we, again, just have to lay this in your hand and say, Lord, we will pray. We will do whatever you ask us to do, but it's beyond our reach. So pray for our leaders that they will have wisdom and do what they can. Pray for those who protect us and do so far away or do so on the streets here at home. And Father, thank you for hearing all of our prayers, whether we spoke them out loud or only in the quiet of our hearts this morning. So, Father, hear us together. We pray the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would the ushers please come forward for the morning offering. Thank you.
Father, with thanks, we bring these gifts to you this morning for all that you have done and all that you have given us. We pray that you will help us to use these as the body of Christ for your kingdom and for your glory. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to read the Palm Sunday passage from Mark, as we're going to continue a few more Sundays in the Gospel of Mark. So, and it's interesting because, you know, after Palm Sunday, there's a lot that goes on between Palm Sunday and Easter. We kind of jump over it, but we're going to read a good portion from Mark 11. We'll start with verse 1 and go all the way to verse 23. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you'll find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here." And when they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. And many people spread their coats on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the field. And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The next day they were leaving Bethany, and Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to find out if it had any fruit. When he reached it, he found nothing but leaves, because it was not the season for figs. And he said to the tree, "May no one ever eat from you again." The disciples heard him say it. On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple area and began driving out those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves, and he would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts. And as he taught them, he says, "Is it not written, 'My house will be called a house of prayer for all the nations'? But you have made it a den of robbers." And when evening came, they went out of the city. And in the morning, as they went along, they saw the fig tree from the roots. Peter remembered, and Jesus said to Jesus, "Rabbi, look, the tree that you cursed has withered." "Have faith in God," Jesus answered. "I tell you the truth. If anyone says to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself in the sea,' and he does not dart in his heart, but believes that he says it will happen, it will be done for him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Most of you know I've visited Israel a number of times. I do like to travel, but I've gone to places where biblical events took place because, for some reason, when I physically stand in the place that some event took place, even if it looks radically different today, I just seem to understand it more completely. The words in the Bible come alive for me. Last week, we studied the Olivet Discourse in Mark, where Jesus sits with a small group of his apostles on the slope of the Mount of Olives and talks about the destruction of Jerusalem, the trials his followers will have in the future and his second coming. This is what it looks like today, looking at it actually from the Temple Mount. And this is what it looks like today, looking from the Mount of Olives towards the city of Jerusalem. The Temple Mount in the center with the Dome of the Rock, the old city, walled city there, and the new city of Jerusalem in the distance. I have to say, it's a very complicated collage of old and new. And if you had been there in 33 AD looking towards the city, this is pretty much what it had looked like. An amazing temple, truly one of the architectural wonders of the ancient world. I like to start Palm Sunday with a video clip. Original Palm Sunday must have been a feast for the eyes. And this one comes from a movie that, in my opinion, is one of the best movies about the life of Jesus, the miniseries, Jesus of Nazareth. We'll watch just about a few minutes of the movie as it shows Jesus' entry into Jerusalem.
The Jesus. He raised Lazarus from the dead.
Who is this Jesus of Nazareth?
He's a prophet, a great prophet.
A prophet? On a donkey?
Blessings to the healing of the sick! You have come to deliver us! Jesus of Nazareth, King of the
Jews! Isaiah 10, Jerusalem, daughter of Zion, behold thy king cometh unto thee, humble and meek.
Son unto the Lord! Son of David!
Master, you are the hope of Israel.
You are our prophet and our savior!
Jesus the prophet, save us! Bless us, Master!
Heal me, Master! Heal me!
Of course, we talk about this event every Palm Sunday. I know some of you know the elements of this event very well, but I don't want to assume that everyone does. So let me quickly summarize a few things that may be review for many of you. Passover was a week-long religious celebration for the Jews, the biggest of the year. Jews literally came from all over the world to participate. Mile Square Jerusalem may have swelled to several hundreds of thousands of people for the event. And those who came from the east or from Galilee ascended the mountains up from Jericho, up the eastern side of the Mount of Olives, passing through the little town of Bethany, where just weeks before Jesus has raised Lazarus from the grave. And as Jerusalem and the temple came into view on the western facing slope, people grabbed palm leaves to wave. They sung psalms. They shouted for joy. It was its own kind of parade. Yet this day they find out that the rabbi who had raised someone from the dead on the road was with them, and a spontaneous celebration breaks out. All four gospels record this event. It's that important. There's so much to say about this day, but really I just want to focus on one element, something within the Palm Sunday story that's kind of a little sidebar that we actually don't talk about very much, but I thought it would be good for us to not be overwhelmed by the big story and talk about this little story. And it is an odd story. Mark tells it differently from Matthew, and that's a bit of a problem. Neither Luke nor John repeat it at all. Scholars have endlessly debated about it. William Barclay, who I gained many great insights from, thinks it doesn't even belong in the Bible, says the story does not ring true. To be frank, the whole incident does not seem worthy of Jesus. And let me tell you, I think he's dead wrong and uncharacteristically misses the point. Let me read it to you again. The next day as they were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree and leaf, he went out to find if it had any fruit. When he reached it, he found nothing but leaves because it was not the season for figs. Then he said to the tree, "May no one ever eat from you again." And the disciples heard him say it. Now the next day they passed the tree again, and what do they see? They passed by it in the morning, and they saw the fig tree had withered away to its roots. So what do you make of this story? Well, let me suggest two things to help understand it. I think first Mark is giving us a clear sign that the story was not about Jesus really wanting a fig, because he tells us it was not the season for figs, right? Everyone knew you couldn't get an edible fig off the tree at that time of year. And I think Mark mentions this to show us that Jesus is trying to use the tree as a teaching opportunity, not just as a source for a snack. You know, I took a picture of a fig tree in Ephesus a few years ago. It was probably a good idea what the tree looked like when Jesus made observations. It had leaves on it, it had figs on it, but they were at a point where they were totally hard and utterly inedible. You know, one of the teaching methods the Old Testament prophets used was symbols and metaphors, ways to act out God's message of judgment. Jeremiah wore an ox yoke on his neck. Hosea married a prostitute. They did visible actions to teach in a very dramatic way the message God had for them to deliver. And frankly, when they do, you do that, it makes the message hard to ignore. And frankly, for someone who had stilled the seas, fed thousands, healed the sick, raised the dead, all in an effort to show people the power and the promise of the kingdom of God, to use the withering of a fig tree to make a point doesn't seem to be completely outside the box. As to what Jesus is trying to say, I think we have to look at the place the story happens. Now, Jesus has been to the temple several times before. We see that in John's gospel. But this time he comes amid a great deal of celebration and expectation. This story surrounds the story of Jesus coming to the temple and actually what I believe is for the second time casting out money changers. So isn't it reasonable to see that the observations of the fig tree is actually Jesus teaching something about the temple? You know, it kind of bookends what's happening there. Now remember, the temple is the focus of Judaism. It is here that people meet God, here that people repair their relationship by sacrifice. Here that people worship God. Here that people celebrate God's relationship with them and remember his mighty works. At the same time, it had also become corrupt on the edges from the original design of a place where all people from all nations could come and meet God. It had become a money-making machine for those in control. All Jews paid a yearly temple tax, including Jews that lived in other countries who had to send their tax in by courier. Well, that was a big fat cash cow. But beyond that, the great moneymaker had also become sacrifices. Sacrifices marked many events in your life. If a child was born, a sacrifice was offered. If you needed to atone for some act, you offered a sacrifice. If you wanted to celebrate the Passover, the lamb for the Passover meal had to be sacrificed on the Temple Mount. Now, all of this was well and good, except you couldn't just bring your own dove or lamb or calf to be sacrificed. These animals had to be pure and without blemish, inspected by a priest to show them to be acceptable. Now, originally that was done to keep people from offering a sick or a dying animal on the altar, really just giving God the worst you had to give. But by Jesus's time, the priests who ran the temple had come up with a great scheme. The only animals that you could now offer were ones that you actually bought from priests in the temple courtyard or outside the sheep gate. The people who sold them there had then to pay a handsome fee to the temple to sell these animals. Well, the result was that you had to pay upwards of 10 times the amount an animal was worth just outside of Jerusalem. People knew they were being cheated, but there was nothing they could do about it. Plus, the temple tax was only accepted in shekels from Tyre, a rare coin not normally used for trade. So you had to change your money issued by Rome or by Herod for these shekels. And the exchange rate at the temple was outrageous. As a result, the chief priests who benefited from this lived like kings in a nation of fairly poor people. You know, if you've gone with me to Jerusalem, you got to see a part of their world when they excavated Jerusalem after the War of Independence. They discovered a whole area on the upward slope on the other side of the temple. And they decided to keep the intact remains and build buildings over it so you can go through, they call it the World Museum, and see there the remains of this sumptuous mansion that sat up on the hill that was covered with mosaics. By the way, remember when Jesus changes water into wine? See those vessels at the very end there? They're made of stone. So because stone does not become ritually impure, that's the kind of vessels they would have used, you know, the Jesus changed water into wine. You know, this is what this place looked like. It actually had its own ramp to transfer people to the Temple Mount so they could take a ritual bath there and not become ritually impure. That's the kind of lifestyle that this kind of activity on the Temple Mount empowered. And you know, that was bad enough. God has never been happy about people becoming rich off his people in his name. But to accomplish this, they had to set this market up within the temple grounds. And the only area available was an area called the Court of the Nations, or the Court of the Gentiles, an area that was supposed to be reserved for non-Jews to come and worship God. Even in the Old Testament, God was showing that his people, that he was the God of all people. And his plan for salvation included non-Jews as well. But that area was then effectively turned into a barnyard bazaar at Passover. It made it impossible for a non-Jew to come there and worship or find God. So friends, let me tell you, when Jesus cries out in Mark 17:11, is it not written, my house will be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of robbers? He literally means it. It's not just a figure of speech. They had turned the place of prayer for all people into a place to fleece the people who came seeking God, all for their own gain. So in the middle of that, when you look, see Jesus looked for good fruit on a fig tree and find that it was producing none, he curses it. And it's easy to see how this is a perfect description of the temple. It looked good at a distance. It no longer produced the fruit it was designed for, and thus it no longer drew all people into fellowship with God. And the withering of this is a dramatic way of Jesus showing what's going to happen in the future. As God moves into the new covenant, bringing people with him in a new way, making the temple obsolete. And you know that we talked about last week, 35 years later, the temple would be destroyed just as Jesus predicted. Now, I know we have a tendency to read these stories in the New Testament, and we cheer a little on the inside, go, way to go, Jesus, you know, smack down those evil temple priests. But I think in a way we're wrong. I really don't think most of these priests were especially evil, but what had happened to them had happened over time, one small institutional decision at a time. By Jesus' time, they were doing what seemed normal and reasonable, even important. You know, more people were coming to the temple than ever. Things were working like a well-oiled machine at this magnificent world-class temple and worship complex. Everything looked great from the outside. It's just that they had lost the big picture by focusing on the details. Forgot why they were there in the first place. It was the typical frog in a kettle. You know, I don't know if this is really true, but they say you put a frog in a cold pot of water and slowly increase the temperature. He won't notice the change, you know, stay in the water until he's cooked. And on the outside, the temple looked like a grand success. And on the inside, it was rotting. It's kind of like what Jesus said to the Pharisees in Matthew 23:27. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanliness. And so you outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. So does that say anything to us today? I think it maybe can. I think it's a warning, not just to them, but to the church throughout the ages. You know, and I got to tell you, I think it's dangerous to assume that a church like ours can't become the temple Jesus visited 2,000 years ago. It's just as easy for us to get caught up in the details and forget the big picture. You know, I've often joked with people that as a minister, it's often easier to get away with preaching heresy in the pulpit than to endure the wrath of the congregation if you paint the walls the wrong color or change the times of the worship service. You know, if you just keep people in the church happy, people will probably ignore the fact that you're not really doing God's work in a way that's effective and culturally relevant. It seems like somewhere written on the foundation stone of about every church, or maybe under it, are the words, don't rock the boat. Not this is the house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. Now, let me just say, I say this not to be especially critical of anything we do. I actually think we do a pretty good job of doing this. But this story warns us to constantly evaluate who we are and what we do, not by our own standards of personal contentment, but how well we measure up to the high calling that God has laid on us. If Jesus showed up here on a Sunday morning and hung around all week, watching what we did, wandering through the community, seeing how we lived our lives and witnessed for him, what would his evaluation be? Would there be fruit on our vines? Would we look good from a distance, but barren upon closer examination? You know, every time I go into Israel, you know, I took people to have a chance to stand in the first century Jerusalem road that runs just below the southwest corner of the temple. You know, I showed you that last week as well, right down there. You could see the places in the road where the massive stones from the temple walls were thrown down, smashed deep holes, sitting there for the last nearly 2,000 years. You know, as Roman troops of the 10th Legion destroyed the temple, and the whole upper level of the Temple Mount, it was a Roman way to really dig it in. You didn't just beat the city, you destroyed it. And the sadness of that loss to the Jews is so great that even today, some Orthodox Jews will tear a part of their clothes as a sign of mourning every time they approach the Western Temple wall. But in truth, God replaced the temple with something better, something that could reach out beyond the narrow geography of Israel and draw, as he had planned, all people to him throughout the world. That's the church. That's us. And I got to say, if we fail to do the job that God has called us to, don't think we aren't replaceable either. Let's make sure we keep our own Palm Sundays alive in our hearts. And let's pray. Father, thank you for this wonderful event that we remember, but also this poignant reminder that we too can find it easy to become too simple, too complacent, too inward, to really worry about the job that you've called us to, and that is that we might be a beacon to all the people, that this might be a house of prayer for all people. Let us always, and everything we do, work towards that end for your glory. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together, please. God has numbered, I was made to walk with him, yet I look for worldly treasures and forsake the King of Kings. But mine is open, my Redeemer, though I fall, his love is sure, for Christ has paid for every failing, I am his forevermore. Tears in times of sorrow, darkness not yet understood. Through the valley I must travel, where I see no earthly good. But mine is peace that flows from heaven, and the strength in times of need. I know my pain will not be wasted. Christ completes his will in me. Mine are days here as a stranger, pilgrim on a narrow way. One with Christ I will encounter, harm and hatred for his name. But mine is armor for this battle,
Friends, indeed, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And may his peace, his presence, and the wonder of his glory be with you now and forevermore. Amen.